pride and a certain desire. So JP, may I call again. Thank you for inviting me here. Thank you especially Viber and the young team. Usually at RTI, we are not used to being called, you know, address, talk and meeting. We are usually called names. So some people call us the Rich Benedicts, Food Soldiers, so Identity Politics. We are Sunni funded, we are Saudi funded, we are corporate funded, we are ISF funded, we are sponsored by the church. So these are the names we are usually called, we are not called talks. So this is an unusual circumstance. All these people who call us, all these detractors, I don't include the young people here who invited me, I still, you know, admire their, you know, courage in inviting us. If all these people specified the church to which we belong, you know, I mean, there are around 30,000 denominations right now, and Saudi funded. There are now factions among the Saudis to be noticed, you know, all the princes are fighting among themselves. And there is the Sangh. The Sangh I have right now around 100 kind of Senas or whatever. So if they specify what Sangh, what Saudi faction, what church supports us, and the people I as well apply to them and ask for a huge share of, you know, sponsorship fees and funds and all. So we know we are not funded in that way. We are not any of these things. And no corporate funds are even pays the least attention to us. This is basically voluntary driven. It would be immensely helpful for any support, but nobody has even asked us, you know, until now. No institution or whatever. So this is one way. I mean, the given talk subject is neoliberal engagement, state, media and social work. I mean, it's all over the place. State, media, neoliberal engagement, social work. I mean, I'm married, I don't want any neoliberal engagement. So, yeah, but it is all, you know, we have to, I am usually underprepared. And my talks usually get scattered all over the place. I hope you can make some coherent sense out of the desperate subjects I'm going to talk about. But when you talk about the media, I don't see the media as apart from the state. So media is, you know, Malthusian, you know, formulation, it's definitely ideological apparatus of the state. So India may fourth pillar and all that, we are borrowed from the liberals in the West, America and the Europe, Western Europe. From a truly democratic perspective, the media is part of the state and it is never, you know, on the side of the people. It might, you know, because it produces most of the ideology, disseminates most of the ideology which the state puts together. And in India, it's very much visible. It is definitely a part of the state, you know, whatever they might define themselves, however they might define themselves as right wing or left wing or liberal, whatever space. Okay, thank you. So we are not sponsored or funded by the church or the Sangha or the corporate or the ISI. Most of mainstream media, which I actually call ManuStream media, is indeed, you know, politically and ideologically also supported by, you know, most of these organizations, and which are, and also indirectly by the state. And so we are not there. How are we a media? Because this is a very, because I am telling about our own experiences as a you know, a work in process, media wala ki. What our experiences, what we are, so that you can see and compare what we mean by media and what could be media and what, because in this neoliberal age, as you said, in this, all this has been possible for us in this, you know, so-called draconian neoliberal age, money talks and nothing else matters. So how may we be born in the neoliberal age? We should be actually extinct by now. All the great officials like us, with no money in the world, we should have been extinct, we should have died long ago. We should have lived only in the socialist age. until 1980 or 1990 or so. So we are an anachronism. In some ways we are an anachronism, but we are also in some other ways a harbinger of the future, a kind of herald. To indicate how the future is, because when we first started, when blogging first started in 2004 or so in India, it was the first time that the conventional media lost, its total grasp, what the people read, talked about, and the information they gathered. And during 2006 or so, I remember when Mandal 2 happened. I remember Barkhadar actually was conducting We the People shows on Mandal 2, and on the next day or the next week he would conduct a show on why blog should not be regulated. But they were so very scared. So I used to run a blog also where I covered Barkhadar actually. So it was kind of rude, but we were very angry at that point of time, and I was only a part of two or three people who were blogging them. So the blogs frightened the mainstream media right from the beginning. And the other online media, even all of them frightened them. It still disturbs them. Yeah, they can't control it. Social media at large. It has become so that now the media has to be verified by what someone says, or whatever that is in the media is verified by looking at what that person who appears in the news is saying on Twitter. You don't know whether the media can be trusted. So you go to say, Priyanka Chopra said something, or Narendra Modi said something, you read it in the media, either online feed sites or in the newspaper, then you go check on the Twitter accounts and see whether this person actually said this. So media itself is, their credibility is such a low, and they have lost it. It's a structural low, where it is, change in larger social forces happening since 1980, 1990. We see it going through conventional lenses and conventional terminology like neoliberal. What does it mean? Neoliberal meant something in, it is derived from the word classical liberal. Adam Smith and others are associated with that formulation. Adam Smith, despite whatever abuse he gets, he was the first one to value. To point out that it is labor which produces all value in the world. And whatever might have been his prescriptions, his intentions were basically towards the development of all. Because the capitalism, he saw it as offering for the first time in history, because a mere spread of disease like a black death in the 14th century to wipe out 30% of the black population. Now, capitalist emergence in Europe for the first time meant that mankind could be saved from a lot of minor, not just health issues, but also the ever present problems of underproduction, shortages, drought, famine, ill health, and all that. I mean, we are from science and technology. Man can be his own master. He doesn't have to pay attention to God anymore. So, this was a egalitarian vision. Then, Marx again improved on it. And then, the sense of equality has been universally a noble idea was brought in by Marx. And Babasar actually gave the very much needed depth to it by saying there can't be no equality without justice. So, coming back to this subject, because describing us as a roundtable India so that we can get a sense of how to compare, and saying this is possible, this kind of media is possible, it doesn't have to be funded by venture capital and then we still be called, pretentiously alternative media, and you can get your tranches, redundable tranches. Venture capitalists give you 11 crores at one go and 10, 20 crores. You don't know when the money is going to come back. And I name them my media also, Newsminute, Watch, Crawl, whatever. And these are outgrowths of the blogging terror. these sites appear because the common man and the one who were accurate. They were not actually, because bloggers, they are mostly 90% upper class, Brahmin, and very highly educated, and many of those who call themselves libertarian then and secular right and center right, now they are part of, in very many ways, part of the think tanks which make up the moderate self of the standard. They are in center right India, they are in meeting mission also, they are in every kind of place, they have research tanks, they have center for social security, civil society, center for internet security, all these kinds of places have born out of this new set of bloggers. Who are born in 2004-2005, they were already professionals working somewhere, engineers, many times public, I mean they were educated in the humanities also, and that many of them have become novelists and writers and poets. So this new crop of bloggers, a new kind of media, gave rise to TheWire, Newsminute, News, all kinds of sites which call themselves alternative news, but there are many institutions behind these sites which actually support them. We know that the Enron family and the Hindu family spawned a lot of this alternative sites. We know that certain left liberal wallahs and CPI, SAPM wallahs actually are directly involved in the support of many art news sites. And some CPM, animal liberation wallahs, because there is no such thing as leaving alone this space, this space is left alone, uncontrolled, not mediated. This could provide to be, when approved, to be a very dangerous space for the ruling classes in India. So they are now also, now you can see the many of them are Dalit writers who are originally written as Dalitable India. They are invited to, because they were already there. When we came in 2009, all these writers were already there. We did not train them, we did not produce them. 500-600 Dalit writers, OBC writers, Pasmanla writers. We did not do nothing in training them or producing them or in any way recruiting them to write. We did solicit, we did encourage a lot of people to write, a lot of our writers here. They were already writers who had no space. ऐसा है कि वो दिमाग तो है लिखने का ख्वाहिश एंड स्किल भी है बट कलम और कागज नहीं है दिस इज द ओनली डिफरेंस दैट बट सडनली व्हेन दिस हैपेंड एंड पीपल देन ऑफ दलित ब्लॉगर्स आल्सो स्टार्टेड ब्लॉगिंग एंड राइटिंग ऑन नॉनटेबल इंडिया एंड देन वेलीवाड़ा हैपेंड एंड दलित कैमरा हैपेंड द मेन स्ट्रीम मीडिया कॉन्ग्लोमरेट्स हैव टू कंट्रोल दिस द स्टेट हैड टू कंट्रोल दिस सो दे ब्रॉट इन Wire, Scroll, Newsminute, Alt News, whatever news. So these people also get to write there. Good for them. I said, you should be paid now actually. So we can't pay them. So this is happening. We have to trace this. All this, we have to know a little context. This is not alternative media. There is no alternative media in India. There are, haphazard, badly organized sites like ours. We did have a certain kind of design in mind, but lack of resources. We wanted to put up all of Baba Sahib literature there, we wanted to put up all of Guru's literature there, we wanted to go back until Buddha, Kabir and everyone, we want to archive all their literature, Periyar, everyone. But we don't have the resources, we don't have the manpower. We wanted to do all that, hopefully these others will do it, but there is a difference. I do understand because many of our people have now come to understand that you can't dismantle the master's house with the master's tools. So even if they write in EPW or in Scroll or Wire or Newsminute, they know that they are not alternative media, they are again writing in the ManuStream media. So, how far are we different? Your description of on the event page on Facebook says Kuffir is the editor-in-chief of Roundtable India, an independent online forum that seeks to raise issues of caste discrimination and exploitation that corporate-owned mainstream media often willfully underreports. He will be speaking on the inherent casteism in mainstream media and its reporters and his experiences against the same. have no problems with us. I'll manage from home. This is written by young people, and it is their perspective. They are still learning. They are curious onlookers, and they are still learning. But the point is, we don't just seek to report our discrimination. We want to upturn the system as it itself. We want to upend the social order. You know, we want to change history. We want to rewrite history. We don't, annihilation of caste discrimination. We don't want to merely report caste discrimination. We want to change the circumstances, the conditions which produce the discrimination. That is the big goal, big outcome. That is what drives us. But I see this in a positive light, whatever blurb appears here. But I would like you to look at certain keywords. Editor-in-chief, which is not exactly accurate. Independent online forum, that is accurate. Issues of caste description, which is partly accurate. And corporate owned mainstream media, which is a woefully inadequate description. I have always maintained the so-called mainstream media in India is more accurately described as the mainstream media. You know, organizer and all these things you choose to appear in the 50s and 60s, they were also very shabby efforts, and they had no funds, and they were putting it together, the Sangis. They were also, they would have seemed like, alternative news media then. And they seemed like alternative news media, and they gave rise to lots of, Swabandha Sutta, Chandan Mitra, and all these people actually were leftists in St. Stephen's or wherever, and then they went to the Sangh. And now see where they are. So they might have seemed like kind of Jolawalas. The Sangis still seem like Jolawalas in certain remote places. So, but they are basically ManuStream media. They have a mission. They have basically a mission. And we also have a mission. They have a caste dharma which they have to uphold. Because I use this very archaic word dharma, because they know the word which describe it fully. Describe it fully through saying, they are after profit, they are after, expanding markets. They don't want to expand markets. If India wanted to expand market, they would have produced their own cell phone. They won't import it from China. I mean, this is happening indirectly. It's not Indian enterprise or Indian capital which is producing cell phones for all, everyone. The Panwalas, everyone, the labor on the fields. They don't want to expand markets. That is the particular character of Indian capital or Indian enterprise. So we have to understand that. That's what I call it. They can't be called mainstream media. They are more aptly described as mainstream media, because the dominant mode of production in India is not capitalist mode of production. I call it caste mode of production. Gail Ombed used it earlier. But she meant it as a kind of different sense. I have a different perception of it. The key word here is dominant. There could be, n number of different modes of production. Marx also pointed that out. There could be a feudal mode of production and capitalist mode of production, and also other modes of production coexisting the same at time in a particular political economy. The dominant mode in most of the West is capitalist production. Most of social conditions are mediated by capital. But here in India, they are still mediated by caste, and I'll come to that later.